Okay, so let's start with one of the most basic questions out there. Do I really need to drink 8 glasses of water every day? Well, the answer is no, you don't. And that idea that you need 8 glasses of water a day is one of those wonderful myths, just like the 10,000 step pedometer myth, which was actually invented by a Japanese company to sell pedometers. You don't need to walk 10,000 steps every day for perfect health. You actually need maybe 2,000 or 3,000. It's the same way with 8 glasses of water. Most of us don't realize that if you're following a plant paradox compatible diet, you're hopefully going to eat large amounts of leaves as a part of your daily diet. And quite frankly, most animals get most of their water by eating the water in leaves and on leaves. In fact, gorillas eat 16 pounds of leaves every day, and they're not sitting near a stream half the day drinking water. And that brings me to an important point that I'll talk about a little bit later, in that plants are probably the best filtration system that's ever been designed to filter your water. So if you're eating organic vegetables, that plant is filled with filtered water. Not only filtered water, but you actually are getting what's called structured water. And I'll have more to say about structured water towards the end of the podcast, so stay tuned. So if you really want to get the genuine article in terms of structured water, get it by eating leafy greens and you're going to get a bunch of it. Now, having said that, there are other forms of getting water into your system, and that includes coffee and tea. And no, caffeine does not dehydrate you. It will not make you lose water. Sorry about that. It's just not true. And believe it or not, wine is mostly water. So these other forms of hydration, not taken to excess, are perfectly acceptable ways of adding to the amount of H2O you're going to get in your body. Can you ever drink too much water? The answer is absolutely, and I see it perhaps more than I see actual dehydration. Most of the deaths you hear about during marathons are from overhydration. And what happens is people hit these water stations and they're constantly sweating out sodium and chloride, which is salt. They're then drinking water, which doesn't have any salt in it, and they dilute out their sodium and chloride, and to a lesser extent, potassium in their blood. And low sodium is really one of the biggest causes of cardiac arrhythmias in marathon runners. And so when you hear about someone suddenly dropping dead on a marathon, it's usually from overhydration. That's why there's warning to marathon participants. Number one, don't drink too much water. Number two, try to hit the sports stations where they actually have electrolyte fluids for you to consume. And interestingly enough, the less fast runners who are out there for 4, 5, 6 hours are far more likely to suffer from this than the guys who are finishing in 2 hours. Of course, I'm up there with those guys finishing in 2 hours, so I've never had a problem. Just joking. So, now, let's get a little controversial. Tap versus bottled water. Bottled water, are there any dangers? Is it really cleaner than tap or simple filtered water? Well, so bottled waters span the gamut of how these are produced. And as many of you know, many of the large corporations, many of the large beverage corporations have bought up bottled water companies. For instance, Nestle, for an example, probably owns more bottled water brands than anyone in the world. And Coke and Pepsi and other bottlers have simply joined in the fray. A lot of these systems use normal tap water that has undergone some form of filtration, and each company uses a different form of filtration. The other, I think, important thing about bottled water is we're mostly through with the BPA scare, the plastics that most bottled waters were contained in. It's still possible to get a BPA bottle. Most of them have been replaced with BPS bottles. But now the evidence is that BPS acts exactly like BPA. So my opinion is try not to drink a bottled water that comes in a plastic container. Now, luckily, there are a number of bottled waters that come in glass. And I personally drink, and I've said this before, San Pellegrino, which is a sparkling water, and we'll get into sparkling water towards the end. Their still water is called Panna, P-A-N-N-A, in a glass bottle. There are certainly other excellent forms of glass bottled natural mineral spring water that you should look for, but try to avoid a bottled water in a plastic container. I've talked about water fasting on this podcast before, but I keep getting questions about it. So let me set the record straight. Water fasting has been around since recorded history, and certainly it's been around since pre-recorded history. Quite frankly, we often did not have food, but thank goodness we had water. We can go without food for months and months and months. There's been human experiments and human beings who have gone over 6 months without eating, but you can only go without water for approximately 7 days. That's how important water is. Now, water fasting, because of its long historical significance, and because fasting is associated with all the great religions, people assume that water fasting is natural and it's safe. And whereas if this was 100 years ago and I'm doing this podcast probably from a soapbox in the town square, water fasting would be very different than it is now. And that's because in our modern environment, we take heavy metals and organopesticides and other toxins, which are now ubiquitous in our environment and in our food, and we store them in our fat cells. And believe it or not, when they're stored in our fat cells, they don't have a huge effect on us. That's why, as I use the example, a giant tuna or a giant swordfish, which is full of energy and full of life, may have toxic amounts of mercury in their flesh, in their fat, but it's not affecting them. So you eat that mercury and you store that mercury in your fat. So when we do a water fast, we virtually immediately start using up our fat for energy because we're not eating. The problem is, as we use that fat, the heavy metals, the pesticides, all the other toxins are released into our bloodstream. Now, our liver is appointed to detoxify these compounds. And we have phase one and we have phase two detoxification enzymes that do a pretty reasonable job. But the liver actually has no ability to detoxify heavy metals. So it says, I'm going to spit these heavy metals out into bile, and the bile will be squirted into the intestines, and I'm rid of it, and everything's fine. Unfortunately, we reabsorb those heavy metals from our intestines, so that many of us doing a detox are actually increasing the level of toxins in our bloodstream because they come out into our bloodstream and we immediately recycle them back into our bloodstream. And so many people, including Dr. Joseph Mercola, who was a big fan of water detox, have really stepped back and said, wait a minute, that's probably not what we should be doing in the modern age. And as many of you know, I developed a product that I use on myself to deal with this issue, and I've written about, if you want to detox heavy metals properly, here's the steps to do. Is there a safe way to water fast? Yes, and just in the longevity paradox, I show you how to do this. You need to complex heavy metals, and the best way to do that is the use of chlorella and the use of activated charcoal. I also think you need to rev up your liver enzymes. Milk thistle is a great way. A compound called D-limonene is a great way. Dandelion greens are a great way. And this is all in the longevity paradox. So please don't just say, I think I'm going to do a 7-day water fast. Peter Attia has backed off on his 7-day water fast and is now this year only going to do 3-day water fasts, which I think is a much more reasonable approach. More amazing episodes just like this one. Watch now.
If you're at the late stage, talk to your oncologist, use the standard of care, and then ask, hey, is this, should we try the fasting making that? Maybe it'll make my whatever therapy work better for my cancer.